This is a special occasion. It's a special occasion to say congratulations to Professor Muchapondwa, but also to say thank you to the family for sharing him with us. So thank you for being here. Thank you for sharing him with us all these years, for the support that you've granted him. He wouldn't have been this productive if he didn't have you as family. And we're delighted to celebrate this moment with you, this moment, his moment with you. It is my pleasure to introduce you to my colleagues on the platform this evening. If you don't know my name, I'm Mamo Kheti Pakeng. Don't worry about the spelling. 99% of the people in South Africa don't know how to spell it, even when they look like me. Joining me on stage is the Dean of Commerce, Associate Professor Linda Roney, who will introduce the speaker after I have introduced her. And then next to her is our inaugural lecturer, Edwin Muchapondwa, Professor of Economics in the Faculty of Commerce. And then next to him is Associate Professor Johanne Dikgang. He will deliver the vote of thanks. He is co-founder and director of the Public and Environmental Economics Research Center in the School of Economics at the University of Johannesburg. Also joining us on stage is Professor Loretta Ferris, our Deputy Vice-Chancellor for Transformation, and Associate Professor Liz Langer, Deputy Vice-Chancellor for Teaching and Learning. The more we consume, the more we absorb the resources of the planet. So says Sir Ian Boyd, Professor of Biology at the University of St. Andrews in Scotland, and the UK's former Chief Environmental Advisor. He points out that Western economies are not the only big consumers. China used 50% more cement between the years 2011 and 2013 than the US did in the whole of the 20th century. The question is, in Africa, where economic growth is so necessary to reverse historic crippling inequality, how do we approach our responsibility to the environment? And this is a question that we at UCT are addressing as an institution as we seek to achieve close to net zero carbon emissions in the next few decades. But it is also a question that we must consider in our individual decisions about the food we eat, what we buy, and the transportation we use. Professor Muchapondwa will engage us on some of these issues today in his inaugural lecture, aptly entitled, Nature Resolves Economic Problems for Humans Naturally. Must Humans Reciprocate? While the practice of giving inaugural lectures is an ancient one and it happens in many places, it is also relevant today. On this platform, those who have achieved the highest academic rank share with us their passion as well as insights they have gained. And today, we are very fortunate to have Professor Eric Muchapondwa to share his work for us. And it is my pleasure right now to invite Associate Professor Linda Roney to formally introduce Professor Muchapondwa. I will not come back to the stage to introduce the rest of the speakers. I've introduced them to you. So after Professor Linda Roney has introduced Professor Muchapondwa, he will come and deliver the inaugural lecture. Thereafter, Professor Dikgang, Associate Professor Johanne Dikgang will deliver the vote of thanks, and I'll come in and dissolve the congregation. Over to you, Linda.
So I have this really delightful task, Edwin. And rather than read out a dreary little CV, your colleagues and head of the School of Economics have put together a little brief resume of you and some of your achievements through the years. So it gives me great pleasure to introduce Professor Edwin Muchapondwa to you this evening. Professor Muchapondwa joined UCT in 2004 as a senior lecturer, having completed his PhD in economics at the University of Gothenburg in Sweden. Economics wasn't always in Edwin's life plans, though. His high school shared a fence with the University of Zimbabwe, so he knew without question that he would attend university right from the start, but he had plans to be an accountant, largely inspired by the fact that his favorite A-level teacher was a chartered accountant. Unfortunately for Edwin, and fortunately for economics, he didn't get enough points to enroll for accounting at university. and so was forced to join the other accounting dropouts in the economics department. Accounting's loss has truly been economics' gain, as Edwin has not only built a truly impressive research career, P.S., he's a C2 NRF-rated researcher, but he has also brought his accounting skills to bear in managing the School of Economics budget when he served as head of school. Edwin Muchapondwa took his first steps in the field while doing his PhD at the University of Gothenburg. This yielded some important life lessons for Edwin. In the summer of 1997, Edwin and other students were invited to the home of one of his professors. The professor was one of the few lucky Swedes with a nice lake adjacent to their house. It was unusually hot, 30 degrees, so everyone was invited to take a dip. Edwin remained firmly at the shore. When the visibly worried professor eventually went to see whether there was something he could help with, Edwin revealed his anxiety about crocodiles in the lake. Since almost all lakes in Zimbabwe are infested with crocodiles. Upon hearing that crocodiles would never survive in Swedish weather, Edwin jumped in and lived happily ever after. Subsequent to completing his PhD, Edwin left his home country, Zimbabwe, and settled in Cape Town, where he later helped start the Environmental Policy Research Unit and served as unit director for a brief period. He continued his research with local communities and park agencies to get a better understanding of their perspectives on the land conflict and has produced a number of international journal articles on this matter. We will hear more of this tonight. But his research productivity is not surprising when you consider that his research focus requires him to spend time in some of the most beautiful natural spots in Southern Africa for long periods of time. A strategic choice, we must say. Over and above his wonderful research career, since joining UCT, Edwin has held every management position there is within the School of Economics, except one, and has served with distinction in every role. He has only managed to avoid the position of postgraduate convener, but not to worry, there's still time for him to complete the full portfolio before he retires. But perhaps one of the most distinguishing features about Professor Muchapondwa is his warm and infectious smile and the genuine warmth that he exudes in all his interactions with his colleagues and students. Known for his football prowess that allows the eco staff a fighting chance to beat their postgraduate students in the annual soccer match, he is also a valued colleague that many will approach for help when thinking through research designs or even contemplating some of life's more existential questions. Always ready with a smile and always happy to share a beer and a story, Edwin exemplifies that perfect blend of head and heart in the pursuit of academic excellence. I give you Professor Edwin Muchapondwa.
Thank you very much for that kind introduction. So I'm deeply honored to stand before you, my colleagues, but also my students and my family. So I am just going to say all protocol observed in order not to waste time. So let me go into my lecture. So nature resolves economic problems for humans naturally. Must humans not reciprocate? But perhaps I should just make a remark that usually my wife lectures me almost all the time. So this is the only opportunity I have had to lecture her. I'm also going to apologize in advance if I am not going to be precise about some of the things I am going to say. This is because, first and foremost, I am an economist. In economics, we are trained to say on the one hand and on the other hand. So there are no one-handed economists. So economists need both hands because we have to demonstrate demand and supply. So how would you do that if you only had one hand? Okay, the outline of my talk is I am going to give an introduction, just making a brief case for the power of economic arguments, then talk about whether economics is devoid of nature. Does it talk about the environment at all? Then I will sketch through some results from empirical research that I have been involved in. Then I'll give some concluding remarks. So economics is important, and we need to talk about it, even though my main interest is around nature or the environment. So you might have come across this tweet by the Minister of Finance, and in particular, the statement which says, the one who controls allocations. And indeed, the world over, ministers of finance are powerful. They control allocations. In fact, that reminds me of some gathering I attended where the Minister of Environment from Costa Rica was speaking. So he told us a story. And for you to appreciate the story, let me show you this question and ask you to reflect on it. Suppose you have half a million rand, which you could use on either of two activities. Which activity would you choose? So you could either provide water holes inside a national park, or you could invest in a youth unemployment reduction program. Where would you spend the money? On the first option. Right, so I expect that many people will say on the first option, because we have a biased sample, all the people who came are interested about nature. But if we just went into, Saronde Bosch asking people, I am sure the majority of them would think that youth unemployment is a very major problem and resources ought to be allocated to solve it ahead of doing something for animals in a national park. However, the story might change the moment you start to fill in a little bit more, describe the scenario a bit more. If you said the youth unemployment reduction program is going to involve 15 youths from Constantia, then you say, the water holes are to make sure that 100 elephants, which normally cross a, cross a certain village in Limpopo, a village with 1,000 people, ruining their crops, damaging their sources of livelihoods. With water holes, elephants will not cause that destruction. So your choice will change. So it is very important for us to be able to go deeper with stories, and in particular, for those who work in the environmental sector, to show the relevance on other economic issues. So by just building or installing these water holes, you will be able to save the livelihoods of 1,000 households, unlike providing livelihoods to 15 youths from a well-to-do area. So the Minister of Finance or Environment in Costa Rica, so he said that once he had a very good idea about what to do in the context of the environmental sector in Costa Rica, and the World Bank was willing to give them a loan in order to do that. So he negotiated all the way through, and the deal was almost ready. However, as with most governments, the only person who is allowed to sign on behalf of the government will be the Minister of Finance or somebody from the National Treasury. So the Minister of Finance refused to sign because he said it's all about the environment. I cannot see people in there. Of course, then he went to speak to some friends, economic friends, and they helped put him a case, started showing how you would reduce poverty in communities adjacent to the areas that he wanted to have an intervention in. So it is important to be able to tell a story on the economic front as well. Right, so I thought what I must do next is just to show the position of nature or the environment in the economics discipline. So the starting point in economics is that humans want to be happy. So they are just looking for happiness. So they want this, they want that. Ultimately, these things, they should provide them with happiness. In order to satisfy these wants, you need goods and services. And these goods and services must be produced using inputs we call factors of production. So there are many factors, many inputs you could use, but we normally just categorize them into four groups. We say land, labor, capital, and entrepreneurship. So land refers not only to the physical land, but basically anything natural. So all natural resources, the whole environment is in there. So many economists, when they look at models, they will quickly assume away land and say, okay, let's assume we have two factors of production, labor and capital, okay, times entrepreneurship. But to a large extent, land is missing. So in other words, natural resources are not spoken about. Okay, so ultimately, the moment you use these factors, including natural resources or the environment, you produce goods and services, you satisfy wants, you generate utility or satisfaction, or in a broader context, welfare. Of course, nature is in there because economics talks about goods and services. So nature has the ability to provide goods and services. And these goods and services also provide satisfaction or utility. So they do this in a direct way or in an indirect way. Of course, the concepts of ecosystems, ecosystem goods and services, biodiversity, so these are all terms we talk about in the environmental sector. But ultimately, we can collapse them to ecosystem goods and services. And these are goods and services which matter for the utility of individuals. So the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment indicated that there are four categories of ecosystem services: provisioning, regulating, supporting, and cultural. In many cases, what is visibly taken into the economics discipline are provisioning services. When we talk about food, we talk about fiber, we talk about water, right? So those are easy. But there are many other goods and services which are provided by nature, which might be missed in economic models. For instance, when you think about the regulating services, regulating climate, or when you talk about the supporting services, just the idea to generate or recycle nutrients in the soil, or just the idea to sequester carbon, or just the idea to be able to generate oxygen, right? So those are important services which come from the environment and must not be ignored. So in other words, economists should know that the environment produces goods and services which help satisfy the wants of people or which enter the utility function. So in many cases, when you are at the National Treasury, so they will often not think about them when they are making decisions about resource allocations. Because for them, they want something in dollars and cents or rands and cents. So some authorities prefer to use money metrics to evaluate everything they spend money on. So the good thing is that one sub-discipline of economics, environmental and resource economics, now has the ability to assign monetary values as well as non-monetary values to whatever nature provides. So whenever we monetize, we call those values economic values, or the total economic value. Economic values do not have to be associated with actual use. So even if we are not using Table Mountain, it could still be valuable. There are values connected to non-use, and there are three categories. So there is the existence value. So this is expressed by people who do not use the resource, who will never use the resource, but they value its existence. Then we also have the option values, and these are mostly useful when you think about plants that might produce medicines in the future. So it's good that it should exist. Bequest values, these are values associated with what we leave for the future generations. So in cases where there are markets, where certain goods from the environmental sector are traded in markets, then obviously they will translate to financial values. And in many cases, many economists will see them. And in particular, the accounting discipline, the one I ran away from. So I just decided not to score enough because I didn't want to do accounting. Okay, so otherwise we have to find ways to monetize, to compute monetary values if we want those stakeholders who make decisions and are interested in money metrics to take whatever happens in the environmental sector seriously. This is just to also buttress the point that in many cases when decisions are made, the Minister's Finance are either thinking, with this intervention, what is the contribution to poverty reduction? What is the contribution to the reduction in inequality? What is the contribution to GDP? Right, so and in many cases, these measures that they are using, they are devoid of nature, right? For example, when we think about the poverty lines, they leave out many ecosystem services, many ecosystem goods, because there is an assumption of a certain basket of goods which can be consumed for somebody to be at the right level. So they leave out those ecosystem goods and services which are not generally available, especially in the urban environments. So which means the thresholds that are determined, in many cases, you could say they are not quite complete, but also when you assess whether somebody is poor or not, that assessment is also not quite complete if you don't take into account the goods and services that they consume from nature, especially on a subsistence basis without passing through the market. So therefore, poverty thresholds are somewhat fake for certain contexts, especially rural contexts. So the most important thing here is that decision makers must actually recognize that nature contributes to human welfare in ways that national statistics do not pick. So the next thing I want to do is to try to give a few examples of the research that we have done, and we can actually show that there is some contribution coming from nature that we were able to pick. But this contribution will ordinarily not be available in national statistics, which are ordinarily used to make decisions around allocation of resources. So when we do environmental income analysis, here we are using the concept of environmental income. So we list all the goods and services that people get from nature on a subsistence basis. And we normally do this in rural settings where there are no markets. So then once we do that, we find a way to monetize, to assign values to the goods and services. So to give examples, so there are communities who will go and collect wild fruits. They will collect honey. They will collect wild cucumbers. They will collect wood, right? Most of those things, they are not recorded anywhere, right? So, and yet, they're actually part of their livelihoods. In some ways, you could say there is a certain income which is not recorded, which if somebody had given them, they could have used to go and buy the wild fruits, the wood, the cucumbers, right? So there isn't a market transaction. But we have to account for that in order to realize that nature is actually performing something good for humanity. Right, so in a number of studies which have been conducted, so including ours, so the range of figures that we get is that poor households depend heavily on environmental resources, on natural resources, and they contribute. So about 15% of the income that you are able to measure, 15% of it would have come from nature. So if you were able to take all those things away and give them in money. So in other words, you can actually see that nature is making quite a huge contribution. So, and it goes all the way up to 50%. And of course, it differs for different communities. And another interesting result we also get is that in absolute terms, the richer households extract more. However, when you look at the proportion of what is extracted as a proportion of income, the poor people extract a greater proportion from nature. So which means nature tends to help the poor people more. Right, and of course, when we get these kinds of results, our idea is not to say that the poverty statistics are wrong, but the interpretation we give is that, so look at 15%. If the environment was not intact, these households would not have been able to get this 15%. So their situation, even though you think they are poor, it could have deteriorated. So which means it's very important for us to be able to invest in the integrity of nature or the environment, because there are some unreported or unrecorded contributions that it is making. Right, and another cluster of studies, not necessarily looking at areas outside national parks or protected areas. Now, when you think about the presence of a national park, so here we conduct impact evaluation, so where we think of proximity to a national park as a treatment. So are those people who are closer to a national park, do they have a higher welfare than those who are a bit further away? Right, so the results indicate that households near protected areas with either ecotourism or limited extractable resources tend to have higher welfare than those further away. Right, so in other words, so this is an unrecorded contribution of protected areas. So they make a contribution which should be taken into account by decision makers who are interested in using money metrics. So then the next thing is we also use some models which look at the social system and the ecological system, how they interact. And by using these models, we are trying to find whether there is something which we can tweak in this system in order to enhance the level of conservation in that system. Right, and of course, we find that there are some things that can be worked on in order to enhance conservation. In many cases, you just need to think about whether there's a threat to the sustainability of natural resources and address that. But in many cases, the problem comes from the characteristics of nature or the environment. Typically, components of nature will have public good aspects, so hence free riding, so they will not be provided in the right quantities. But the other aspect is that they will have common pool aspects. So where there is no owner, we can all go competitively and try to extract it. So we notice that in many of these cases, what we need to do in order to enhance greater protection is to assign property rights, especially in the case of common pool resources, and that can make a difference for sound conservation. So then when we look at this issue of property rights, and in fact, it's this kind of conclusion which has motivated calls in literature for devolution, that whenever you see that a resource is not being well managed, one of the things you can think about is the property rights. Are they assigned in the right way? Maybe if you tweak the way you assign them, you might solve the problem. And this is particularly true in cases where there is contestation between local communities and the state. So in many cases, the state claims that this area is ours, conservation should take place. But the communities think this is their ancestral land, and they do not respect whatever is in the books. So it does not make sense for the state to insist that this is a protected area, it's ours, and send two rangers when a community of 1,000 people is defined, right? So those are the cases where devolution can be thought of. And the work we have done indicates that communities in many cases can actually be trusted to be good stewards of nature. However, there are some conditions that you need to check, and institutions. And here we use institutions in the way it has been used by Elinor Ostrom, the Nobel laureate. So she talks about institutions as being the norms, the strategies that people come up with as they interact between themselves, but also with a resource. There are certain design principles of institutions which promote sound management. So all we need to do, we should not fear communities, we should not be afraid to give them a right to co-manage resources. We just need to first appraise their institutions when they are interacting with nature, and in many cases it's possible to use the desired design principles to help reform certain things that we might think is not appropriate. Of course, we realize that allocation of property rights is not a panacea. So it doesn't work in all cases. And there are two major issues that we have uncovered why at times, even with an assignment of property rights to communities, you might still not have a sound conservation, right? So the threats in many cases to natural resources have not been mitigated because of the nature and the structure of benefits. So many community-based natural resource management programs, they tend to emphasize benefits to communities rather than benefits to households. So some of the work we have done, for instance, in Zimbabwe, there is a program called the Campfire Program. So it's a program where the government has given ownership to manage the wildlife resource in buffer zones to communities in those areas. So those communities, they sell licenses for trophy hunting. So when you hunt an elephant, you can raise something like $30,000 US. And think about $30,000 US for a community which is living on less than a dollar per day. So that can be quite substantial. However, what has tended to happen in these cases is that the money is used mostly for social infrastructure. So either they will go build a clinic, or they go and repair a classroom block at a school, or they build a house for teachers so that you attract better teachers, or houses at clinics so that you attract better nurses. Or in some cases, if there is neglected infrastructure, they will go and build a bridge because they are no longer able to cross a certain river. The bridge which was there was washed away and the government is not doing anything. Right, so this is something good at the first level. However, one needs to move to the second level where you also think about how to incentivize the households as well. And of course, the ability to do that requires that the revenues or the budgets for conservation are augmented. We started thinking about how revenues could be augmented, especially in areas that are close to protected areas or national parks. So we think that national parks can be used as a medium for collecting some money from tourists, which would be earmarked for the communities. Partly, you will pay them because they make a contribution to conservation. In many cases, even though you have a protected area, it's usually a part of a larger ecosystem. And this ecosystem will stretch outside the protected area. So it does not matter how good the management is within the park. If they do something to the water outside, your animals will die. If they do something, you know, so which means these areas are connected in some way. The health of the protected area is dependent also on the health of what happens outside. So you might want to incentivize perhaps protection of certain watersheds which are outside, so that the flow of water into the park, through the park, is good enough to sustain the populations that you have. So they incur a cost and they have to be compensated for that. Of course, park agencies themselves don't have enough money even to do things inside the protected area because the transfers from the state are always going down. So they cannot spare any money to share with the communities. So we have been investigating whether charging appropriate prices for tourist products could be one way of raising additional revenues. Right, and of course our results indicate that it is possible. And here we use choice experiments. So where we go to tourists, we talk to them and we give them some scenarios. These scenarios allow them to tell us how much they are willing to pay for a certain attribute of conservation. So it could be the ability to see the big five 50% of the time, or it could be the ability to see a lion in Chobe National Park 3 out of 4 times, right? So they express a willingness to pay and say, yes, you can increase the entrance fee if you are able to use that money in order to enhance conservation so that I can increase the likelihood of sighting, say, the cats in a protected area. And of course, some of the attributes that we speak to them about are attributes whose provision require limiting use, imposing restrictions on the community. So on the other side, we also go to the communities and say, there are these restrictions. If we place them, that would increase the populations of the lions or the cats in general. And then tourists are able to see them more often and they're willing to pay more. So are you willing to trade off your right to do these activities and rather accept compensation so that these restrictions can be imposed? So what we have seen is almost like we are thinking about a market. We are gauging whether there is demand and supply, but for things that are not ordinarily sold in markets. And we have realized that actually communities are willing to trade off. So they can say, yes, we will stop cutting down trees in this national park on condition we can be compensated. And if you don't cut down trees, obviously there is an environmental good whose quantity will improve. So there is that possibility. Okay, so, so our studies have indicated that for a number of parks that we have been looking at, so we have been doing some work in Masai Mara, in Kenya, Serengeti, in Tanzania, Kruger, the Kalahari, so Chobe. So there is evidence that this trade-off works, and there is evidence that tourists are willing to pay more as long as we can assure them greater environmental goods and services or recreation. Okay, then the last set of studies I'm going to talk about is, remember I say that the budgets have to be augmented if we want communities to be able to help with conservation. However, it's not only about money. So there is also something else that can help enhance conservation. This is knowledge. So we have gone into the field and we have some experiments in the field. So we frame an experiment around conservation. So a group of people, they have a population of elephants that they are managing, and they can poach if they want. So we have different kinds of versions that we play with them, but there can be some offtake. So we are trying to find the conditions that enhance conservation in the minds of these communities. So what kind of things can we tweak in their circumstances, which can help enhance conservation? Of course, there are things that have been found in other experiments, in other settings. When you have punishment, if you are able to punish each other for not doing the right thing, yes, communities will do the right thing. But one additional thing, which we thought was very important in the context of nature, is knowledge about nature. So communities have indigenous knowledge. So it's not that they do not know, so they know quite a lot about nature. But in many cases, they have been alienated from resources for quite a long time. So the working of the system is no longer the same as they used to know. So there is now modern knowledge which can be shared with these communities to help them make some decisions. So in this experiment, we experiment with reaching certain thresholds where if you harvest your stock beyond a certain level, then there will be extinction. So when we play these games with the communities, when you do not give them any information about the stock dynamics, most often they will extinct the stock, which actually explains the behavior that we tend to see, communities not caring. But the moment you start providing them information about the stock dynamics and they realize how the stocks change and what that also means for their livelihoods, they start being cautious. They become more and more pro-conservation, right? So this is the kind of work that we have done. So I thought I should just sketch, without going into very detailed results, to give you an idea of the kind of work that I do, and to demonstrate that there are actually some tools, economic tools, that can be used to generate numbers that those economists in authority, who in many cases are working against conservation, would be interested to hear about and change their minds about resource allocation in the conservation sector. So in conclusion, I note here that many countries, especially developing countries, have a tendency of not wanting to care about nature. And I think this comes from a lot of the studies that were done. It started off with work on inequality, Kuznets. So where they were showing that when an economy doesn't have a very high income level, they don't care a lot about inequality. Income has to rise up to a certain level for them to start caring about doing something about inequality. So the same result was taken to the environmental sector, and they said, when countries have low levels of income, they do not care about the environment. It's only when the level of income rises sufficiently to a certain level that they start to care about the environment. However, when we go to the local communities in poor countries, the results do not support the result you get at a national level. Yes, a poor country might not have great interest in the environment, not want to commit resources into it. But the poor people in that country, they care very much about the environment because a lot of their livelihoods comes from it. So conservation or the environment is one of the few areas where there is a meaningful and inevitable role for government to play. So governments must play a role in this, and playing a role includes allocating resources to the environment sector. When it comes to communities, which is what I focused more on, because a lot of my research has focused on communities, devolution and institutions are the key. So we should trust communities as long as their institutions are pro-conservation. So let us give them an opportunity to be co-managers of the environment, and the outcomes will be better. But of course, benefit sharing schemes matter. We need to make sure that they have incentives to do that. And research suggests that there is a consumer surplus, especially when you think about international tourists. They are going back home with a lot of change, which they express that they're actually willing to leave it. But they can't leave it because the entrance fee is only $20, right? So they would have left it if the entrance fee was $30. Of course, this is more important when you go to other countries like Masai Mara, Serengeti, where people flock to see the wildebeest migration. Very important when you go to Chobe, almost the only place where you can easily see the cats. So the pricing has to be right. Otherwise, in general, economics has a suite of policy instruments that exist which could be used for the environmental sector. So with those few words, I thank you, and I invite my colleague.
colleagues, family, and friends. My name is Johanne Dikang. I'm the Director of Public and Environmental Economics Research Center at the School of Economics at the University of Johannesburg. It gives me great pleasure to give a vote of thanks to Edwin for a very interesting and stimulating inaugural professorial lecture. As we may all be aware, a professorial or a professorship is a career pinnacle at a university, and therefore it should be earned. Unfortunately, that is not always the case, but I would not get into the politics other than to say it leaves one with a question of really, what exactly is a professor nowadays? I looked around to try understand in different places what a professor in an ideal institution or ideal country or environment, what a professor should be, and got a few interesting insights. So a professor is a lot of things. Professors need to have something to profess and capacity to professor. A professor needs to have standing. They need to have weight in terms of their research and also have academic credibility. And I'm glad to say Edwin has all these things. So Edwin's research area, as you may have noticed in his lecture, lies in community-based wildlife conservation, environmental valuation, institutional arrangements, impact evaluation, as well as economic policy. His research makes a significant contribution. It sheds light on how areas within proximity to protected areas can be used or can be managed as a whole in a manner that enhances conservation, complementary land uses practices, and discourages conflicting practices. I think what has been really good about his lecture is that he's not only demonstrated that he is a good and capable researcher, but he has also demonstrated how it can make a difference, his research can make a difference, or makes a difference. And it is a testament to Edwin as a person and as an academic. I've known Edwin for 12 years now, and I know that besides being a capable researcher, he's an extraordinary person. He is very committed and very enthusiastic. That is demonstrated by the various roles that he has held within UCT, such as being a co-founder for IPRO, Environmental Policy Research Unit, hosted at the School of Economics, as well as having been the director of the School of Economics, and also internationally, where he is a South Africa country representative at the European Association of Environmental and Resource Economics. He is also a board member at the Swedish Environment for Development Initiative, and as well as a secretary general for the newly formed African Association of Environmental and Resource Economics. You can't really underestimate some of the enthusiasm and drive that he has instilled. So from my point of view, I would like to thank Edwin for all the hard work that he's done. UCT is really fortunate to benefit from his commitments as well as his talents. I have first-hand experience of this, as most of you would know. He was my PhD supervisor not so long ago. Maybe now it's a while ago. I left this place 2012. And thank you also to Edwin's family for coming along. Families are behind all of this, and their support over many years, as has been indicated earlier, is the reasons why occasions like we are having today are possible. So thank you very much for being here. I hope you've all thoroughly enjoyed the lecture as much as I've done. So with no further ado, I've been told I've got only 5 minutes, so I think I need to wrap it up. May I please ask all of you to thank Edwin once again for his fascinating talk by giving him a round of applause. All right, Nkosi, thank you, Kia Leboga, thank you very much.
Johanne Kase Harona re go leboga rona re leboga maoto. Thank you very much for giving the vote of thanks for Professor Muchapondwa. Professor Muchapondwa, I clearly gave you a new name when I welcome people here. I called you Eric. And I was just thinking as I was sitting there how many times I did it. I was looking at your wife and she was looking at me very seriously. But because I'm seeing her for the first time, I thought that's just how she is. But now I understand, especially after you said the bit about lecturing. So forgive me for giving you a new name, Edwin. Forgive me, Mrs. Muchapondwa, for changing your husband's name. I'm just doing this so that you don't give me a lecture at the end of this. On behalf of the UCT Council, Senate, and the entire UCT community, Professor Muchapondwa, I congratulate you on your professorial appointment, and also thank you for your contribution to our institution, our continent, and our world. I wish you many more years of professional success and personal fulfillment. Congratulations on reaching this far in your career. Ladies and gentlemen, join me in congratulating you. And now to you, thank you very much for joining us for this lecture. Inaugural lectures are amazing, they're wonderful, but there wouldn't be anything if there was no audience to listen. So thank you very much for joining. And of course, this is the School of Economics, so they do it the African way. There's something to eat after this, so join us for refreshments outside at the end of the lecture. Please rise for the platform party to leave the room.